Hey, Brittany.
Hi.
Everything set up in the other room?
Sounds good.
Hello, Brown Sky. My name is Red Chief Moss. Welcome to the Great Plains. Just in case anything like this ever happened, we made a travel
Great
brochure
Plains.
Just on your arrival.
Alright, let me see. What are we doing? Alright, let me see.
Alright, let's walk this way.
Where am I?
Oh, wow! This TV is so spacious! Nice couch out there.
American Great Plains. This beautiful land, covered by the great and mighty bison, is populated by the Plains Indians. They live, like their ancestors thousands of years ago, on the grassy fields which characterize the land spanning from the Rocky Mountains to the Mississippi Valley. These great people of the plains are nomadic hunters and gatherers who rely on the patronage of the great buffalo spirits for food, shelter, tools, clothing, and spiritual wholeness. Even their comfortable homes, known as teepees, are made of buffalo hides. These people's wonderful cuisine is based primarily on buffalo and wild vegetation. This is eaten fresh in the spring and fall, while in the winter, the meat is dried, ground into a paste, and mixed with fat to produce the scrumptious dish known as pemmican. The buffalo, when hunted, is not wasted one bit. The skins and hairs make up their fashionable clothes and shoes, while using their teeth for jewelry. The hunting of buffalo is very dependent on horses, making them a sign of wealth. This makes the plains a great destination for American tourists because it allows for cheap meals and lodging. While these hardworking people spend the daytime gathering food and hunting, you can visit many of the great events taking place in the village, such as their baseball/lacrosse type games, or their captivating yet often unhealthily smoky religious traditions. Their world-renowned sun and rain dances, or one of their cave painting galleries. All of these traditions are dependent on the buffalo hunt, which allows for hunters to gather the nourishment necessary to allow for leisure time to be spent maintaining their rich culture.
And I'll tell it and speak it and think it and breathe it. and reflect from the mountain so all souls can see it. And I'll stand on the ocean until I start sinking. But I'll know my song well before I start singing. And it's a hard, it's a hard, it's a hard, and it's a hard, it's a hard rains are gonna fall.
Ready to hunt some buffalo.
Boys, I was very sad.
Nice work,
after we have a nice buffalo hunt, here we go.
Party!
See all those Indians?
Yeah.
I killed them. All of them.
You serious?
Well, I remember it like this.
For 250 years, we waited for this opportunity. Since Coronado's expedition, the Plains Indians began to hone their fighting and hunting skills, making them an enemy so formidable that no one, not even the conquistadors or the colonists, dared venture into their territory. Coronado tried, but was turned back repeatedly. The Spaniards decided to leave this area as a buffer between us in the Northeast and themselves. We all came to the conclusion that the Great American Desert belongs solely to the Indian and buffalo. From the west of the Mississippi Valley to the Rocky Mountains, from Canada to the heart of Texas, lay this unconquerable land. It was not until the Louisiana Purchase that this land was reevaluated. Captains Meriwether Lewis and William Clark first ventured into this beastly wilderness. all the way to the sea. And even they could gather few praises for this land. Soon afterwards, Lieutenant Zebolan M. Pike named the plains incapable of cultivation and claimed that they should be left to wandering and uncivilized aborigines of the country. He also dubbed it the Great American Desert. Some people even proposed to leave it uninhabited and to turn it into a national park for the Native Americans and their bison. However, once California Gold Rush and the migration of the West began, scores of settlers began passing through the prairies. Some began to settle down with their herds of animals and families. These land-hungry settlers began to flood the plains, inhabiting every empty nook and cranny. Thus, they began to drive the Indians and their bison out of their beloved homes. For the first blow was the occupation of much of their land. However, the final and most effective blow was the slaughtering of the American buffalo. While the Indians did trade about 100,000 buffalo hides with us in the 1840s, once we came in, professional hunters, we shot the dumb beasts with our new powerful long-range rifles. We could sit 200 to 600 yards away and pick at the animals without scaring the herd. We could bag about 150 of those suckers a day. As the Indians tried to move their herds away, we followed like a dog follows a bone. We continued to cash in this lucrative resource. The 90 million buffalo population in 1800 was cut down to a mere 750 by 1890. As Sioux Chief White Cloud once said, wherever the whites are established, the buffalo is gone, and the red hunters must die of hunger. This is exactly what happened. That resulted in the Plains Indians leaving the plains and their culture and moving into reservations because they no longer had the buffalo, on which the entire way of life was dependent. Now they were dependent on our government's reservations. The entire culture was almost completely eradicated. The suckers! We wanted to depend on us for food and clothing so that we could move them out of the plains and make room for our settlers. And killing the buffalo did just that.
Oh, so that explains it. I thought you were our friend, and you betrayed us.
Brittany? Brittany, sorry, Brittany. Hello?
Go!
Yo, Prince, A+!